Hello everyone, welcome back to Cycle and Beyond. Thank you so much for all the love and all the support you have been giving me on this channel. So in case you have missed my previous video, which was how to pedal from Pune to Goa, it's just there in the description. Even you can check out the link which is there on the screen. And in case you want to do the preparation of the same, that video is also available. That's also there in the description, and you can hit the link which is just right above your screen. So today in this video, I am going to share one of my past cycling trip, which was from Manali till Leh Ladakh and till Khardungla top. I did it solo, unsupported, without any support vehicle. So who doesn't know Manali Leh Highway? It's a a dream destination for every Indian and a mandatory check-in for all the motorcyclists. And last but not the least, it's the Makkah of every cyclist. Yes, if you aren't aware, you can pedal all the way from Manali till Khardungla without even spending a single penny on a motorbike, on or a petrol. Well, what you will get? You will be able to see most beautiful landscape, endless highway, beautiful weather, nice desert land, and you will see those beautiful blue sky which you have been seeing on your monitor screen. So back in 2018, I imagined mountains, I imagined rivers, and I imagined an endless highway. But what I imagined differently was a bicycle. Yes, I thought how different it would be to pedal from bicycle from Manali till Khardungla. And if you know, Khardungla is one of the highest motorable pass in the world. Yeah. Now the problem started when I actually started to prepare for this trip. So when I started to book my flights, fix my itinerary, fix my dates, I was really wondering what to take on this trip, what to expect on those highways, and I was seriously not prepared. Trust me, I was clueless of every smallest thing I can think of. I was not clear about the route, I was not clear what challenges I will face, even I was not aware what all things I should carry on this trip. In this video, I am going to bring in along the route, the fooding, the accommodation, and what to expect out of this trip. Let's talk about the route first. So as you know, Leh Ladakh is the land of passes, as we call it, and every pass is different from the other. So on this trip, when you are on this highway, you would be crossing major passes. So you have Rohtang Pass, you have Bararacha Pass, you have Lachungla Pass, you have Tanglangla Pass, and the most visited and the most show-off pass, the Khardungla Pass. So once you reach Manali, I assume that you are prepared and you wanted to take this adventurous journey, maybe solo, maybe with your friends. I would suggest taking with your friends, because sometimes it's quite boring. So my day one in Manali was, I started roaming around this city and just seeing what exactly is there. Not staying back in the hotel, just, acclimatizing myself around the surrounding. And I would really recommend you to visit the nature park of Manali. It's really wonderful. You have a really nice, good trails in the mountains. You have a river flowing just, next to the park, and it's really wonderful. When I started my journey on August 12th, my day one was from Manali till Mari. Okay, so it's a total distance of 37 kilometers, I feel it's your first day, so trust me, your legs are going to be tired, because when I started riding, I felt it's easy. Quite easy, but it was not. It is as difficult as any other terrain. So from Manali till Mari, you have almost an uphill. There are few downhills which you will see as part of this route, but mostly it would be an uphill ride. Since you have completed your day one, you are pretty much aware about the surrounding. I must feel that you would be seeing lots of beautiful scenery all around the Manali and Mari. And since I went in the month of August, it was raining and it was drizzling all the way from Manali till Mari. So when we go on the day two, my day two plan was to reach Sisu, which is by crossing the Rohtang Pass. So I started early from Mari, so I would recommend day two should be starting from Mari, crossing the Rohtang Pass and going to Sisu. So from Mari to Rohtang Pass, I'm telling you it is going to be uphill ride, complete uphill ride. From Rohtang Pass till Sisu, you have a pure downhill. And but if you are going into the in a rainy season, you would encounter lot of slush after you cross the Rohtang Pass. So what's your day 3 gonna be? I think your day 3 should start from Sisu to Jispa. Not much of an uphill. You will see there's here and there you'll find an uphill ride. It's quite scenic too, because then the scenery from Manali till Sisu is going to change now. You would have seen lots of green trees there, but now you will see barren lands, you will see, you know, mountains without even a single greenery. So now that you have reached Jispa, your next destination should be Zingzingbar. So from Jispa, Zingzingbar is going to be not too difficult, I'll say, but when you will reach near to Zingzingbar, you will feel the uphill rides are going to be really tough. So be prepared for that. So day 5, you should go from Zingzingbar till Sarchu. From Zingzingbar to Sarchu is going to be a downhill ride. But trust me, when I say downhill in the mountains, it's not always downhill. Sometimes you'll get a little bit of an uphill and then you might enjoy the downhill as well. So while crossing Zingzingbar, you will be crossing Bararacha Pass as well. So now you have covered Rohtang Pass, Bararacha Pass. Okay, now you have more 3 passes to cover on this highway. You can keep your day 6 from Sarchu to Viskinala, and you will be crossing Nakila Pass there as well. Okay, now your 7th day. 7th day is what you will be crossing the third pass of this route, which is the Lachungla Pass. Your journey will start from Viskinala till Debring, and in between you will be crossing the Lachungla Pass as well. Now we are almost about to reach Leh. So we have next destination, which is from Debring, and from Debring you will be crossing Tanglangla Pass, and after crossing Tanglangla Pass you have Lato and then you have Leh. Now I would suggest to either you split those distance in 2 days, or you could push yourself and reach Leh in 1 day itself, because once you cross Tanglangla Pass, it's almost a downhill ride. It's time to hit the last pass, which is the Khardungla Pass, which is the highest mountable pass in the world. And I'm going to tell you one thing for sure. This pass is really difficult of all the passes that you have crossed. And since you have been tired since 8 days, I would recommend you to have at least 2 days in Leh, so that you know you get acclimatized there. But eventually I'm telling you this fact from the experience that since I crossed all those altitudes, I never felt that I need to acclimatize, because I never felt any sign of any headache, any nausea as such, and everything was pretty much normal. But the number of days in which I have split it is really going to help you, because the distance is not huge. 40-50 kilometers every single day, but trust me, those 40-50 kilometers on that highway means a 200 kilometer on a plain surface, because it's that difficult. So all the information with respect to the day wise, it's all available in the description below. You can check the complete description and you can plan your day accordingly. I would recommend you to keep at least 8 to 9 days on this highway, so that you enjoy every bit of the journey. And few things you can say as a tip, that I would suggest not to get impatient at any point of time. Just be patient, enjoy that every single ride, click lots of pictures. I thought that it's my journey, I'm not going to spend much time on clicking pictures, but today, now I regret that I should have more videos, more pictures, and I would have covered everything. But when you take this journey slow and take this journey patiently, trust me, it is going to be the best journey you will ever encounter in your whole life. Since you know how to split your days, how to pedal each day, I think the second most important question is the food part, and on top of that, the accommodation as well. So even I was skeptical whether I'll be getting good food there, but somehow you know, at every dhaba that I have taken my dinner or lunch, gave me very good food. The rajma chawal was really awesome. The eggs were taking a lot of time to boil, almost more than half an hour. So my suggestion would be not to carry too much of food with yourself. I would recommend you carry some dry fruits, and also if you want, if you would like to do lots of snacking, I would recommend you to have chocolates as well, because it will really help you to go through those high altitude passes without any problem. Because I remember carrying almost 10 dairy milk, and I used to have at least 1 to 2 bites every single day. If you're traveling solo, people recommend to have a tent, but I did not carry a tent because I felt every location has something to offer you, and it's pretty cheap. I mean, like, you can get a bed for $200, and you can get a very good bed which is in a homestay, which would not be available after Jispa. So that would cost you around 500 rupees, I guess. So I'm not sure about the current situation there, but every dhaba that you would be eating would have an accommodation available as well. So don't worry about that. But in case you are really worried about the hygiene part, I would recommend you to have a tent. Now that you're aware about the route, you're aware about the food and accommodation, I think the most important thing is to carry few medicines as well. I would suggest you to carry at least 10 pouches of ORS, which is one pack a day. So it will really help you to hydrate your body, because you are exposed directly in the sun. The sun is really harsh. Your body will really dehydrate, and sometimes you will feel that dehydration coming into picture. In order to avoid that, I would recommend you to at least have 2 or 1 bottle, complete water bottle, early in the morning before you start your ride, and have a very small sip so that you don't just let it go. Your body keeps hydrating, and it will help you to maintain that hydration for a longer duration. I guess you are pretty much equipped with all the information. I'm really happy, and I would be really glad if you want any information, you can comment down below. You can reach me on my Instagram as well. The link is just right in the description. So feel free to ask any question what you have. Keep supporting this channel because it helps me to create new content on Cycle and Beyond, which is going to be very helpful for everyone who is doing cycling. Till then, thank you so much for watching Cycle and Beyond, and keep pushing your limit, keep exploring. Thank you.